Welcome to the Resilience Conversations, a portal into the world of inspiration and creative thinking about finding our inner strength and learning how to use it. I'm Rondi Charleston, and I'm so excited to share some practical, helpful, and in some cases, mind-boggling insight from some of today's most highly respected thinkers, leaders, and artists. I hope you'll join me in this fascinating series about learning and cultivating the essential qualities of resilience. Tell me a little bit about living your values, because I know that's been, and we've sort of gone over it already, but just it might be a good thing for people to think about.
Well, I think that we often project out into what other people should be doing, and we forget, you know, Alice Walker said the most common way we give up our power is not realizing we have it in the first place. And so I just am a big believer that before I want the world to change, I've got to really make sure that I'm living in accordance with my values. I tell religious people that, hey, before you tell me about your religion, first show it to me and how you treat other people. And to me, it's so critical that we do everything we can to manifest the truth of who we are and never underestimate how that's going to affect people around you. And so I've been imperfect. I know that there are days I don't live up to my integrity, and every day I have a moment that I can try to live my values, live my spirit. I always tell a funny story about, you know, as a vegan, I sometimes succumb to the desire to go to this place about a block from my house called McDonald's. It's terrible seduction that this place has because they have these things called French fries. I don't know if you've ever heard of these things.
Fries?
I don't know if you've ever heard of them.
Wow, never heard of them.
And so I remember being online in the drive-thru, you know, sort of embarrassed at my weakness. And you get these French fries, and I've just put forth legislation to legalize marijuana, deschedule on the federal level. But I think these French fries are so addictive, they maybe should be scheduled.
As an addictive substance.
Yes, it's an addictive substance, yes. And so I'm so happy
but
about
these. But you can have them because they're not meat.
Yeah, they're not meat? No.
Your one thing you can really sin.
And, well, I found out later, so I don't have McDonald's fries anymore because they fry them, I think, in a way that's not as vegan as it should be. But I'm holding these two large fries in the back of my, like I'm from Lord of the Rings, my precious. and I see outside a guy who is has his head in the garbage. And the guy that was driving me, a Newarker, went to the military, came back and enrolled in the police academy, police detective that's been with me for a long time. I tell him, stop for a second. I ask the guy, hey, do you have, do you need anything? Are you okay? He sort of waves me off and I go, sir, are you all right? And he says, is there anything I can do for you? He goes, I'm just hungry. And so I know there's something in the Bible that says something like, if you have two McDonald's French fries and your neighbor has none, that you should share the McDonald's. So I wave them over and I open the bag and the smell hits me and I shake my hands shaking as I hand over one of my fries. And he looks happy for a moment, but then he looks in pain and just says, hey man, do you have any socks? And I immediately knew, and you know, that he had something going on with his feet. And I don't carry extra socks in the car with me. And I said, I'm sorry, I don't. And as soon as I say those words that I don't have them, I suddenly see Kevin, the detective in the front seat, put the car in park, reach between his legs, kick off his shoes, take off his socks, and hand them through the window.
Wow.
And the man who took these socks looked like he'd just been handed a bar of gold. And here I am preaching kindness and compassion, but I didn't have the moral imagination in that moment. And I'm a couple blocks from my house where I have socks I haven't worn before,
right.
Sitting down, and I didn't think that I could in that moment.
Overall, I think you have a great moral imagination.
I appreciate you saying that. But my point is that we always think of life as a big change. Like, I'm going to do something really big someday. Mm-hmm. The reality is every day, the biggest thing you can do is usually a small act of kindness, decency, or love. And we often don't know how that ripples out into the universe. I went back to interview the lawyer who represented my family when we were turned away from houses in the town I grew up in. And these lawyers and the Fair Housing Council organized sting couples to like go behind my parents to find out the houses were still for sale. And so I went to go find these lawyers that made a difference in my life from, you know, 50 years ago. And I find the main lawyer who organized them all, his name is Arthur Lessman, he's since passed away. And I said, why did you do what you did to help black families integrate your neighborhood? And he says, well, let me tell you, I know exactly the moment I made the decision. I was sitting comfortable on my couch watching TV, and in breaks the news from a movie I was watching. And it was this these marchers going from Selma to Montgomery, and I watched on the news as they got stopped on the Edmund Pettus Bridge, beaten with billy clubs, blood. It was all so horrific that I went to work the next day and told my partner that we got to go to Alabama. And my partner laughed because we were too poor. We just started our business, could barely afford a plane ticket, not to mention to close our doors. And so we just sat there for a second and we decided, you know what? We may not be able to change the world, but let's do the best we can with what we have where we are. They called around, found the Fair Housing Council, and started. And I often tell the story just to think for a moment. Those marchers failed that day to make it to their destination.
Right, right.
But just by them standing up on that one day, they unleashed the power of love that leapt 1,000 miles away and changed the heart of a guy in New Jersey that would then go on and change the outcome for generations yet unborn.
The ripple effect.
The ripple effect leaps space and time.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think those marchers ever knew until I told some of them as a senator, when I got a chance to award them one of the highest medals from Congress, I don't think they ever knew that they had an impact in this world well beyond their imagination, that their act changed the outcomes for generations yet unborn because of the inspiration they set loose.
And that's resilience.
It is absolutely resilience. And you and I both know this, sometimes resilience is just getting up from a day of pain, of shame, of hurt, and that little voice that says, I'm going to get out of this bed anyway,
mm-hmm.
I'm going to put on my clothes, and I'm going to go to another day of living and loving, despite it all, I'm going to live and love and do small acts of kindness. That ripples in ways that we don't even see sometimes. And I've had moments like that. One other quick story. I was on a plane, and you've had these moments where I get on a plane, packed plane. I'm a college student at the time, playing football at Stanford, going on this cross-country from California to New Jersey, 3-6 hour flight, packed flight, all the seats on the plane taken except for two next to me. And I'm gleeful, came to the only conclusion that I could think of is that God loved me more than all these other people. But then this woman comes on the plane with a baby crying like crazy, and a little boy sits in my seat. And I remember thinking to myself, this is going to be the worst flight of my life. But then I realized, wait a minute, I'm surrendering my power. Every moment is an opportunity. And I thought to myself, this is either going to be the worst flight of my life or it could be a challenge to make this the best. And I started talking to the woman. And as soon as I got out of my own drama, I realized that she was in the most uncomfortable position in the plane because everybody's looking at her as if she caused her baby to cry.
Right.
And so with compassion, we started talking. Long story short, the plane flight, I'm playing tic-tac-toe with the kid. I'm telling them all my worst jokes that I have made for little boys and girls, which, like, why did Tigger and Eeyore have their heads in the toilet? Because they were looking for poo. Flight went like...
Excellent.
Yeah, thank you very much. I got a lot of material.
Good one.
If you ever want to do a corny joke show, if you have a dad joke show,
yeah,
I'm ready for
you're
it.
You're ready. You are ready.
But the flight was so quick, we exchange information, we don't stay in touch. 5 years pass, 10 years pass, I'm in the worst fight of my life in Newark, New Jersey, trying to run for mayor. Back against the wall, on my most discouraged day, I get a letter in the mail saying, you may not remember me, but I'm seeing you in the news now. It reminded me of what I thought was going to be one of the worst flights, first time I was ever flying with my two small children, and God gave me the blessing of sitting next to you. And she talked about my kindness. She turned out to own a factory in the city of Newark. She ended up being a contributor, had me come to her factory. The little boy that I tortured with jokes that probably had to get psychological interventions afterwards, he became one of the best volunteers on our campaign.
No,
it just,
fabulous.
It just, yeah, so you put things out in the universe, you never know.
You never know.
Impact they're gonna have and how the universe is a balanced place. And that, in fact, I don't think it's balanced. In my life, it hasn't been balanced. My balance sheet is way out of whack because I've received so much more from the universe, no matter how determined I am. So I just, resilient, we all have to be resilient. It's in our DNA.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that we're here alive on this planet is from the resiliency of our ancestors under unimaginable conditions, persevered.
Right.
We have the ability to persevere now. But again, the most important thing we can do on any day, and you know this, is choose resiliency. Choose your attitude. Choose your state of expectation. Choose to interpret everything that happens to you as an opportunity for you to show up fully, to tell your truth to this world, even if it's in the smallest gesture, tell your truth in every moment. And that kind of resiliency, more so than presidential actions or congressional decrees, that kind of resiliency changes the world.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
You are just an amazing
human
being.
No, you are amazing.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
I'm crying.
No, thank you. Thank you.
Wow.